A fluid flowing through a pipe invariably enters the pipe at some locations. The boundary layer on the walls quickly grows until it reaches the center line of the pipe, and the flow becomes fully developed. The region over which the velocity profile of the fluid changes is called the entrance region. Past the entrance length, the flow becomes fully developed, meaning that the rate of change of all the main quantities along the flow stream direction is zero, except for the pressure. The length of the entrance region can vary significantly, depending if the flow is laminar or turbulent. From the analysis of extensive data on laminar and turbulent flows through round pipes, these two empirical relations have been found to give a reasonable estimate of the entrance length based on the Reynolds number. Reported here in this plot, we can see how the entrance length varies with Reynolds number for the laminar and the turbulent flows. For large Reynolds numbers, we can have the entrance length that can be several hundreds of pipe diameters long. Any relations that describe fully developed flows cannot be applied to analyze the flow in the entrance region. So it's very important to know where the flow becomes fully developed. Now, let's consider the flow through two pipes. They have the same length and diameter, and we want to analyze a laminar flow and a turbulent flow passing through them. Let's see what goes on inside the pipes. Shown here is the contour plot of the flow velocity magnitude on a vertical section of the pipes. The black lines show us the velocity vectors at different locations. The length of the lines is proportional to the intensity of the velocity. As you can see, the velocity profile for the laminar case and the turbulent case is completely different in shape due to the different characteristics of the two flows. Let's plot now the center line velocity along the ducts. The laminar and the turbulent entrance length are roughly reported here. The laminar case reaches fully developed condition much earlier than the turbulent case due to the low Reynolds number. We analyzed how to empirically determine the entrance region. Now we are going to study the fully developed turbulent flows in pipes and channels. The first case we introduce is the flow in a circular pipe of radius R, with certain velocity profile forming in it. Recall that a laminar flow becomes unstable around Reynolds number of 2000 and becomes fully turbulent for Reynolds number of 4000. For laminar flows, it's possible to obtain an exact solution to this problem through the Poiseuille solution. However, for turbulent flows, we cannot obtain an exact solution, but only approximate expressions that can give us a reasonable velocity profile. For fully developed turbulent flows in pipes, we can assume that the entire flow is affected by viscosity, and that the velocity should follow the universal law of the wall. Hence, we will have a laminar sublayer really close to the wall, then a transition to the log layer, and a specific profile near the centerline region. Let's recall that in these expressions, the V-star term represents the friction velocity, and the y coordinate represents the distance from the wall. If we assume that the logarithmic distribution comprehends the largest part of the boundary layer, we can obtain an approximate estimate of the average pipe velocity. This can be done integrating the log law along the pipe radius. Blasius derived an empirical form of the friction factor, or pipe friction factor, based on the average velocity. Using this expression, we can also derive these other three relations that show us that the average velocity is essentially a screen friction relation. We can then introduce the Darcy friction factor, that is equal to 4 times the pipe friction factor, and rewrite the relation into this form, that was originally derived by Prandtl in 1935, using the constants K and beta equal to 0.41 and 5, respectively. This expression is a good first approximation of the friction factor. However, the formula does not take into account the viscous sublayer and the centerline region. Prandtl improved this relation, changing the constants so that the solution will be a better fit with experimental pipe friction data. This is valid for any Reynolds number larger than 4000. Reported here is the variation of the friction factor with Reynolds number for laminar and turbulent flow. In the transition region of Reynolds number between 2 and 4000, we have bursts of turbulence appearing in the flow, and this is a region that we typically try to avoid when designing a pipe system. Another approximation that can be used for a turbulent profile in circular pipes is the power law relation, where the n parameter is a function of Reynolds number. This is a reasonable approximation for practical turbulent pipe flow, and a value of n equal to 7 reflects a wide range of many practical flows. Hence, it's common to find this relation used in its 1/7 power form. This velocity profile has some limitations. It's not valid near the wall and near the center line. This because it provides an infinite gradient of velocity at the wall and a non-zero gradient at the center line. The profile of a fully developed laminar flow and a fully developed turbulent flow are significantly different. The laminar profile is much more pointy compared to the turbulent one, that presents a much larger velocity near the wall. This is because the turbulent flow has much more momentum than the laminar flow. Now, let's consider a turbulent channel flow between two parallel plates. If we take a look at the velocity contours and velocity vectors along the channel, we can see that it looks similar to what we have seen in the round pipe. Indeed, using a similar analysis, we can obtain an expression for the Darcy friction factor for the channel flow. This expression is very close to the circular pipe expression we derived before, and predicts a friction factor about 4 to 7% higher than in the circular pipe. The similarity in the expressions and results leads us to the unified expression for non-circular ducts. Indeed, the Darcy friction correlation derived for the circular pipe can be extended for analyzing any non-circular duct. This simply introducing the concept of effective diameter that was originally proposed in 1976. The expression uses the effective Reynolds number that is based on the effective diameter. This parameter is calculated using the skin friction coefficient and the Reynolds number calculated using the laminar theory. This relation is purely an empirical correlation that does not have any theoretical background and was only verified through experimental tests on ducts with different shapes.